You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment. Very good, Gene
Johnson. From Los Angeles, California, and Maria Menounos, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On. Spotlight On is a long-form interview series featuring actors and TV personalities. And now, from the world's number one TV after-show platform, this is AfterBuzz TV Spotlight On.
This is a great song. We have a really cool guest today, and this is kind of his theme song, I would say. I don't know. It's your personal theme song, okay. We're here with a man who has produced shows on the CW, TLC, National Geographic, Animal Planet, E!, and most notably, Lifetime for the entire Dance Moms franchise. He's also the president of Collins Ave. He is also a very, in my opinion, I think you're a very talented TV host. You kind of do it all. You're a singer, which I'm sure people don't know, but you'll hear more today.
Aren't you full of compliments?
Jeff
today?
Collins, everyone.
Hello. My gosh, can we do that again?
I slow like
that
clap, slow clap.
Slow clap.
Slow clap.
Is this the AfterBuzz internet clap? Okay.
This is the, yes, it is. Right. My phone, get rid of my phone. All right, what's up? What's
I've
up,
never
Jeff
had
Collins?
An introduction like that before. That was good.
Really?
Yeah, you should just follow me around and say nice things.
I because people would don't love always. To do that. How many times did I compliment you when I walked in?
I know she did.
I think you're hot. I think you have a great banging body.
Well, and now we know you're blind.
I'm not blind. You have a banging body. I don't really, honestly, I have to say, I'm slightly hitting on you. You're okay. Very good looking.
You
Jeff
know,
Collins.
I can, it's been a long time
it's
since anyone's hit on me. But.
Well, listen.
So hit away.
I'm hitting. I'm slapping.
Yeah, you don't even have to do that because I'm so forthcoming anyway. So if you're trying to butter me up to get the goods, like you didn't even have to do that. But I appreciate the extra effort.
I knew that there was a lot underneath. See, listen, guys. Whoever knows Jeff Collins, you know him from most notably from Dance Moms, the reunions. He, you know, does all the hosting for that. I always thought there was some part of you that was so mysterious. Really? Not in like a set, like obviously I think you're super hot, but like it was more like, I want to know more about him because you don't give a lot. Like you know, you're there to do your job, to tell the story.
Well, I'm not that friendly. So maybe that.
I think you're super friendly.
Well, I mean, I am to you because you were nice to me, but just in general, I'm sort of that guy.
Yeah, but why would
you see me out and about? I'm not, I was talking to a shrink recently who said to me, no, it wasn't a shrink. I was talking to an executive coach mm-hmm. and because I'm going through some executive coaching to figure out how can I be a better leader. And she was asking me all these questions about me. And she said, oh, you're an introvert. And I went, I am. And she said, yeah, you kind of listed all these things. And she asked me like, what are you like at parties? Are you the kind of person that's gregarious and goes around and says hello to everybody? And I said, no, not at all. Are you the kind of person that gravitates to someone you know? Yes. Do you like not mix well with others? That's me. And I'm like, oh shit, I guess I am an introvert. Like, I guess I'm really not that friendly. Like,
but you know what? The introverts that become extroverts once they're comfortable are the best extroverts there are.
Okay, well, I'll go with that.
Like, people like me, you don't want to hang out with people like me because I'm like, I talk to everybody. I'm like,
yeah,
it's
I'm not
a little,
like that at all.
I talk to everyone. I'll go to the side of the street to somebody at Ralph's. I'm like, hey, what's up? How are you? You want to be my friend? I mean, like, you're like, you pick and choose. You got a cool posse, I'm sure.
Well,
cool
I don't
gang hanging out with you.
Yeah, I mean, the thing, you know, I am terrified of forgetting people's names. And so I'm the worst at that. And so I have a phobia of even meeting people because I forget to go, you know, they said, well, you ask someone their name and then you use it again in a sentence and then you say it two or three times more. And I've never been one to do that. And I just sort of launch into a conversation because it's easier for me to just start talking.
Yes.
Than it is to go with the pleasantries.
Do you ever find that when you are hearing someone's name, you're not really in the moment thinking about that? You're almost thinking about the next thing you want to talk
totally.
About? Okay, me too.
I'm thinking like, why are you talking to me? Like, what do you want from me? Like, what? Do you know what I mean? I'm thinking like, how can I be interesting to you? Because I'm sure I'm really boring. Like, whatever it is you want to know. So I'm not thinking
That's
about
our
that.
Problem, though. It's that right. We're not in the moment because I'm terrible. I think I inherited it from my father. He
I think
calls
you're not
everybody
really into
buddy
me,
boy.
Or you're just asking me something. You want some information or something.
Yeah.
So I always think the worst. Yeah.
Right. No, I'm totally. I actually had some horrible experiences with that where I've met people a million times and I don't know their name.
It's, me too. Yeah.
I can't. If I'm with somebody else, I can't introduce them. I have to be rude.
It's terrible.
It's horrible.
Terrible for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And especially being in this business, when you need to know people's names, it's like the worst.
The thing for me that's the absolute worst is that when I'm with my peers and my colleagues, because there are a lot of things where production company owners and producers get together for different types of conferences, or we see each other.
Right.
You know, and these are people that I genuinely really like and respect. But then when you put them all together in one place, now, mind you, these are people that I don't socialize with outside of work. They're, right. You know, this is professional settings. These are people that I know professionally, but I don't see them a lot. I see them 3 or 4 times a year, maybe, you know, when you're talking about one person.
Mm-hmm.
And so, especially when you put everybody together in one place and you have all your memories going, oh my gosh, that's so-and-so who owns this company or produces that show or does this, or I met him the other night at, you know, a dinner party, and it just, my mind freezes because I get so terrified of it.
I get it.
Terrified.
I get it. I know it's terrible. And then you're already fearful of it in the beginning, so you already like psych yourself up.
Yeah. I love those people in movies. Like, you know, I think it was in Anna Wintour when they, you know, The Devil Wears Prada, where she had an assistant that would just walk around and whisper, this is so-and-so. You've met him at the party. This is, I'm like, wouldn't that be great to just have that?
That would be amazing.
Like, Google should invent that.
You know what?
Yeah.
That would be a brilliant money-making plan.
Yeah.
Really would. I mean, but even so, like, if you're having meetings and stuff, you already know ahead of time, but it's like, it's those people that you
bump into.
Right? Yeah, it's the worst.
It's terrifying.
And it's so insulting on their part because they've known you and you don't remember their name.
And some people are really good at remembering names. Like, I have people who've come up to me that I'm thinking, oh my gosh, I've met you once, and that was 6 or 7 months ago. And
you're memorable.
No, I don't know that
it's
that. I think that it's, there are people who are really good at that. That's a skill.
You think so?
I remember one time when I was doing what you're doing, but I was a young associate producer, an assistant on Entertainment Tonight.
Yes.
Which is when you were probably in diapers.
I loved
it. But there was, I remember one time, I started my career, I was Lisa Gibbons' assistant, and she would interview like all the really big stars. And I remember meeting, she met, and I was with her, Arnold Schwarzenegger, who was, you know, friendly with her, and he was a really, really big movie star. And I remember this thing that Arnold Schwarzenegger would do, and he would come into the room, and he would see the crew, and he would see the cameraman and the audio man, and he would remember their names. How are your children? So-and-so and so-and-so. How have you been? Is your mother better? And I thought to myself, oh my gosh, like, that's brilliant. How does the guy do that? And then later, he becomes a politician and governor. I thought, okay, that's probably why.
Well, he's the Terminator. That's why.
But I thought to be able to be smooth like that, you know, come into a room full of people who are all behind the scenes people and remember their names and say hello to them. Now, mind you, he'd met them before.
Right.
But I mean, imagine if you were in that situation and you're a movie star, how many people would you meet in the course of a year?
I understand.
Look at the people that you meet in the course of a year. Like if you ran into them at the grocery store, would you remember their names?
It's terrible.
It's terrible.
I ran into somebody at a restaurant that I know that I've had
that's been
multiple
sitting here. You
conversations
interviewed them.
With him. Multiple.
Right.
I called him Devin or something. He's like, it's Steve. And I'm like, I wanted to die.
Right.
I couldn't fix it. I couldn't make it. It was done.
Yeah, it's horrible.
I ruined it.
And it's terrible when you do that thing like, hey, you, how are you? Oh my God, it's so good to see you.
Yep.
And you know they know. They're like,
exactly.
Asshole, you don't remember my
name.
Yeah,
and then you're standing next to somebody. You cannot introduce them. It's the worst thing. You have to, it's just awkward. And then you're just praying that they, or you do, this is also kind of brilliant. You'll do, oh, do I have your phone number in here? Do you mind just putting it in?
That's a good
one. I do that one a lot. But then if it's like, or if I'll say like, how do you spell your name again? They're like, Amy, A-M-Y, then I'm fucked. I'm like, oh, all right. That almost worked, but.
Dave?
Yeah. Well, I'm like, some people spell with an I-E and then they know, they already know you ruined it. But that's, it's just, try
it
one time. If you really need something, that's like a last resort.
It's the effort.
It's the effort. Let's get into, though, speaking of Lisa Gibbons, I really want to paint a picture for people of how you began in this industry, because I just see somebody who is a natural in front of the camera. And I have been wondering since I first saw you, like, what does he do? So you moved to LA after you went to college and you did singing, correct?
Yeah, I was a voice major in college. And I was, after college, I ended up in the big Las Vegas style shows, some in Las Vegas. And I ended up in one in particular that was in Reno, Nevada. And the genre, don't be offended, ladies, is called to this day, tits and feathers. Okay, and when I asked you on the phone, do you know what tits and feathers is?
I knew.
You knew what it was. So
my
what that means is
Vegas,
like when you see those old movies like from the 70s, and of course it wasn't in the 70s, it was in the 90s when I was doing it. you saw the girls with, you know, the rhinestones and feathers and big showgirl outfits, and they were the ones that that genre was created, and that was what they called it, was tits and feathers, because the girls were topless, the dancers were topless.
But it was like, was classy though, like it was a classy way of show. It was like artsy almost.
It was very artsy. The guy who brought it to Vegas was this very old producer named Don Arden, who is in the Guinness Book of World Records for having his name on a billboard longer than any person in history. And I first got to work in one of his shows when I was 21 years old. And he was a very old man at that point. And there are only one of his shows left, and it's called Jubilee. And it's at whatever I think it's Bally's might be the name of the hotel. Now, come full circle, Anthony Burrell, who was one of the choreographers for us on Dance Moms and in Abby's Ultimate Dance Competitions, in Abby's Ultimate Dance Competition, is a choreographer that was invited to go back there and refreshen that show.
You're kidding.
With a couple of other really big name choreographers.
And full circle it
is. So I ran into him recently, saw him somewhere, and he said, oh, Jubilee, you know, we're talking about the fact that it was a Don Arden show.
What did you do in there? Do you sing?
I was a singer. I wasn't a dancer. I was a singer, yeah.
So we didn't get feathers on you?
No. Okay. I didn't do any of that. But I did have to. I used to do, when you were a singer, you had to do the big production numbers with the full chorus. So I did dance, but I was in the back row in the corner with the tall
still
guys
did it.
Who, you know,
don't take that.
I wasn't
away.
Like one of the really great dancers. I was like, I was a singer who could move, is what they call
what
it.
What would Abby give you, a 1 out of 10? What would you give
Abby?
Her? 10 being the best.
Would be really rough on me. She would probably tell me that I was not cut out for that career. And that
hey, at least she'd tell you the truth.
That I probably need to go get a job waiting tables, which is actually what I did. You know, when I ended up in L.A.
So I came out from Vegas to LA.
Well, I went, you know, I was working in a lot of places. I think my last stop before coming to LA was I was in a show in Miami Beach, like for, you know, the winter. So then I came out to LA, and I was in my 20s still at the time, and I thought I was going to be famous. Because that's what you did. You know, I'd worked in all these shows, and I'd always, you know, gotten jobs because I was tall and I could sing and I could move and I was good looking, I guess, halfway decent. And so I thought, well, that's what you do. You come out to LA and you know, you get famous. And so I got here and they were like, do you write songs? And I'm like, no. And so we were doing lots of showcases. I was trying to be a singer. So there were showcases. That was the thing. You did showcases all over town. You'd go work with a band. And you'd, you know, get 6 songs, and then the sly part of it, or I should say the part where they got you, was in order to be on the showcase, you had to guarantee that you could get 10 of your friends, right, to come and pay $15 or whatever. So that was $150. So if there were 8 or 10 of you on the showcase, and everybody was responsible for bringing in $150. Well, the guy who's putting on the showcase, who was the promoter, he took the loot, right? So you're basically just paying the guy. It was a whole scam.
Exactly.
It was a total scam.
But you still got exposure, and you still got to practice, hone your craft.
I don't know if we got any exposure. I mean,
you never know.
You know, you felt guilty because you kept calling all your friends going, hey, can you come to another showcase and pay $15 and see me sing again for like the 10th time? And no, I don't have a record label. And yeah, there's like these record people coming.
Right.
Because that was always the scam, is they promise you that, oh, there's going to be record people there. And you're going to be seen by all these people. Mind you,
they still have those today called casting workshops for actors.
Right. I did those too.
Oh, you
did those
too.
Yeah. You pay like, you know,
you have to
pay
them.
It was a lot. It was like $400 or something.
Oh, God. Where did you go?
I went to one that was, you know, it was several, you know, weeks and weeks and weeks.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. It was like an ongoing workshop. And the scam was at the end that there would be a legitimate, you know, casting director who would come and see you. And it would be, you know, 30 people in the class who've all paid $400. And you go through, what, you know, 3 or 4 weeks worth of sessions, and then at the end the casting director comes. Well, you know, they were just divvying up the money, and the casting director had no intention of ever calling you. And
no, actually, one casting director out here actually does not even use agents. He will cast right out of workshops.
Really?
His name's Scott David. That's the only person I know of, though. He does like Criminal Minds and stuff. Everybody else that I've ever gone to.
So he goes to work. So it's legit?
There are some legit ones now where you pay like $35 and you'll be seen in front of a casting director. Mm-hmm. They'll give you some sides. You have like 10 minutes. But I had my 5 minutes of wanting to be an actor too. Yeah. And I was like, yeah, that's not for me. Because like you, I didn't want it as much as the air you breathe, as you said.
I feel like I was easy prey to the lowest of the low. Of the Hollywood scam system. And I'll tell you what did me in, and I haven't thought of this story in years. I was working with this guy who was a musical director, and we were you know, and they kept saying to me, do you write? Do you write songs? And I'm like, no. And so they said, well, you need to have original material. So, I'm working with this guy who's coaching me a little bit, and he's supposed to be a manager. And so he says to me, well, you know, I know this brilliant husband and wife writer team, and I can get them to come, and for a month, we'll literally lock the doors and we'll roll up our sleeves and we're going to come up with, like, you know, 8 original songs for you. But I need you to give me money in order to pay their stipend, right? And because they have to live. Yep. But they're really talented writers, and he's giving me, showing me all these songs they've done. And so this is really what did me in. This was the clincher. And I remember this. It was $6,000 is how much he wanted. Okay, it might as well have been $60,000. I didn't have $600. So I put it on my credit cards.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I did. Fell for it.
Oh, no.
So they show up. They legitimately show up. And I worked with them twice, I think. And they got in an argument and fled and bolted with my $6,000.
Those.
Not just the two of them.
Oh, I would love to find that.
The manager as well. Yeah, bolted.
Wow.
Took off. So I think the whole thing was just a scam to
of
get the
course.
Money.
Of course.
And that was when I was just like, I can't deal with it. Yeah. I don't want to be famous that bad.
Yeah,
I don't
no.
want to be in business anymore.
I think we all have those moments where we realize, it's like a realization, and it obviously costs a lot to get that realization, yeah. but then you realize it's like, this is the crap you have to deal with.
It just felt like one scam after another another, and
right.
I wasn't connected. I didn't know anybody, mm-hmm. and maybe I wasn't that talented. I don't think I was that talented. I don't think I wanted, everyone said, you know, in order to be an actor or to be a singer, you know, and I really wanted to be a singer, and I thought maybe acting was just a pathway to being, you know, a recording artist, which is what I thought I was going to be. I think that I just was so taken advantage of, and I was so green and so naive, and I was willing to do it, right. that it was just one after another after another, and I realized I don't really want this that bad.
Right.
I'd rather do something else.
Where are you from?
Originally? I grew up in Asheville, North Carolina.
Okay. Well, yeah, it's not like, I mean, if you were from New York or something, it's like maybe you'd have a little more of like an
no.
you know, like city like mentality.
No,
where you
I had
just,
zero.
You just trusted people.
Zero and, city mentality.
Yeah.
Zero city. And I still trust people a lot. You know, I do. People that come into my circle. I'm not a micromanager. If I hire people to do something, and I trust them to do what they said they could do. And I trust them until they give me a reason not to.
I found out here more often than not, I meet people that seem so normal, and then there's just that thing about them, and you're like,
right.
oh my God. And it's like, well, all these people move away from their families. They're all here for selfish reasons, in a sense.
Right.
So it's not like you're out here to meet friends. That's secondary.
Right.
You're
right.
here to do what you got to do.
Right.
But
And everybody has an agenda. Everybody,
yeah,
you just
of
have
course.
To realize that. Everybody has an agenda.
Right, right.
Yeah, Hollywood's different.
It is different. But toughened you up, obviously, because look where you are
so.
Now.
I think so. Yeah, I think so.
But I don't think you got that. Some people get successful, you know, by cutting someone's throat, doing whatever they have to do, stepping over somebody.
No, I've never had to do that.
You
don't
just
do
did
it now.
The real
it's
way.
Not worth it. It's not
right.
worth it.
So it just shows you guys that you can just do it the real way.
I try to be fair and reasonable as much as I can.
Right.
Know? But when people, sometimes the people on the other side of the table are very unreasonable, so.
Right. Well,
what are you going to do, right?
I think at the end of the day, it's a learning lesson.
Right.
$6,000 to learn a life lesson, I guess, right?
Yeah, I mean, look, I see myself on the, you know, I see myself in that story, and I don't ever want to become that person who's taking advantage of people. So
you never know. That's
but,
not
you know, reality TV, like, I think that a lot of times people assume that what we do, you know, I own a production company. There are a lot of people that work for me. I'm not involved in every decision that's made. I trust people to make the right decisions. I think that people a lot of times assume that we as producers, that it's up to us the way the show gets made. And I often try to explain to people, like, look, we do have a lot of say creatively in the shows, and we are the ones who initially come up with the creative. But once it's a series and a network is involved, you know, there's another voice that's present at the table,
mm-hmm.
and the people who are on the shows and the people who don't always realize that they don't always, you know, they always blame me for everything that's
Who's
going their way.
You? I
no,
want
that's
their
not
names.
Going their way.
I want their
you
names.
Know, they blame me for everything that's not going their way. Oh,
he's popular.
My brother. My brother who never calls me.
Oh,
and now he's calling.
Well, you'll have to call
now
him
he's
back
calling
me.
I'll call him later.
It's all right. We'll call him later. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't care. You could pick up the phone.
No,
there's no
right.
rules here.
No, that's
no
right.
rules. but okay. So yes, I want to know about Collins Ave. I do want to. So basically, you went from not wanting to do acting. You said, "Screw
yeah.
this," basically,
right.
and then you start working for Lisa Gibbons.
I was a cater waiter. Can I get you a cocktail, ma'am?
Oh, you did that.
Yeah,
because okay.
I could not make the showbiz thing work, and I thought, okay, I am smart enough to figure this out. And I'd been a waiter in college. You know, I grew up like middle class, like, yeah. You know, didn't come from money and always had to work when I was in college and in high school. And so I was a waiter. I waited tables. And so when I got out here, the catering thing, I'd never seen that before. You know, you go with a catering company and work in rich people's homes, mm-hmm. and celebrities. And so during that process, I met Lisa Gibbons, who at that time, she was like the babe on Entertainment Tonight. Well, she still is a babe.
I was just going to say
she's
that.
Totally
she's
totally a babe today. I shouldn't say that. Sorry, Lise. but she was like, you know, on Entertainment Tonight, and I was a cater waiter in her home. And because I was from the South and she was from the South, we kind of connected on that level. And then every time that I would see her name come up on the board at this company, this cater waitering company, I would say, oh, I want that job. It's, you know, it's Miss Gibbons and I really like her and she likes me and let me manage her party. And so she was entertaining a lot. And over the course of like 3 or 4 or 5 times, you know, over the course of like a year, we sort of got to know each other. And I remember one time I was standing in her backyard and she said to me, what do you really want to do with your life? And I thought, oh my goodness, this is my opening. And I said, well, funny you should mention that, but I really want to be someone's assistant. I really want to get a job in show business and learn about television, and I'd love to be someone's assistant. And I said, you know a lot of people, a lot of famous people. If you could ever recommend me, I think I would be really good because I'd be willing to cook for people and I would clean their house. I'd pick up their dry cleaning. I'll wash
cute.
Their car. I'll take care of the kids. I'll do anything, Ms. Gibbons. And she said to me, well, what about me? And I go, I was thinking, oh my gosh, this is too good to be true. She said, yeah, you know, I have an assistant who wants to become an editor. She doesn't want to be an assistant anymore. And if you come to work for me, you know, maybe I can find a space for you. And if you prove yourself, then, you know, we'll see what happens from there. And so I started my career with her. And I didn't know anything about, you know, her job or what she did. And so I would cook for her at home sometimes and throw parties. And she was literally paying me personal checks, like out of her personal checking account to get me started. And I was still cater waitering. And so it was to see if I could learn the job. And then as her assistant moved on to the actual, you know, editing job that she wanted, I was able to take the salary, the mm-hmm. assistant salary.
Yes.
And that's how I got started.
Well, see, they say you have to
willing,
ask out here.
You have to ask.
Yes.
And you have to be willing to mm-hmm. do anything.
Yes.
I was willing to cook. I was willing to wash cars. I was willing to pick up dry cleaning. I was willing to do all those things, mm-hmm. all that were things that she needed because mm-hmm. she was a very, very busy star
yes.
who was doing a lot of stuff. And she trusted me.
Right.
You know, to do that. And from that experience, I learned about Entertainment Tonight and how it was made, and I learned, you know, how to handle her schedule and how to book and how to make appointments and do research for all the interviews that she would go on, and that's how I got started.
There's a fly in the room, so I'm sorry.
There's a fly. It's okay.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Your work ethic really showed that, you know, she could trust you. I think that your
right.
willingness, there's so many people out here that I'm not doing that.
Right.
No, I'm not doing.
No, I was willing to do anything.
If you're not willing to do that, then you're not going to be willing to do anything else. And
right.
who are you?
Right.
You know, the fact is, at the end of the day, we're all just trying to prove ourselves.
Well, and I mean, perhaps that's what that's how I ingratiated myself to her at the time is, you know, I would say, well, you know, do you want to have a dinner party on Friday night? Like, I'll cook, you know, you can invite your friends or you can do whatever. Can I go shopping for you? Hey, how about your car needs washing? Can I have the keys? I'll go get your car washed. And so I think it was because my willingness to do all those things at that time,
yes.
you know, and I didn't have a sense of entitlement.
Right.
I was willing to do anything.
Right.
Because I understood how tremendous the opportunity was just to be around her and be on a hit show and be observing what was going on. I thought it was the best education that you could ever get. And look, I'm not going to say I didn't make a lot of dumb-headed mistakes and I wasn't like, you know, cocky and...
Right.
You know, because I was really insecure and I was around all these people who were seasoned producers and I was new and green and, you know, I remember the first day I showed up to work, I went and I was wearing like my cool little vest and my tie and, you know, and it's like production.
Yeah.
And I was like really overdressed because I thought. And
like
I think
prom.
She, yeah, but I think she thought it was cute, you know, and she kind of like let me get away with stuff like.
I love this.
But
love...
no one else was. You know how people dress on a show? They were wearing
yeah.
jeans and
yeah.
t-shirts and the head writer wore flip-flops and board shorts every day.
But
and here I was like with my little tie because I was from the South and I was really, you know, proud that I was working on Entertainment Tonight. It was
a
big deal.
And you had a lot,
job on the Paramount lot.
But you had a lot more of a city mentality than you're even
right.
giving yourself credit for.
Yeah.
The fact that you knew that this was an opportunity.
Yeah.
And that you step from the bottom up. You literally are right. One of those people that started at the bottom.
No, I absolutely started
That's
at the bottom.
That's amazing.
I started
No
at
one
the
would know that about
Cooking
you.
Cooking and cleaning and washing someone's car and was grateful for the opportunity. And you know what? And she lived up to her part as well. Because I remember she always said to me, she said something to me that I carry very dear with me to this day. She said, I will trust you until you give me a reason not to. One. And two, she said, information is knowledge. So I will share with you all the information about my career and how this job works and who the contacts are. And you can be in the room when I'm on the phone, because that's the only way you're going to learn
yes.
about how this works. And I'll trust you until you give me a reason not to. So, you know, I never gave her a reason not to trust me. I understood how valuable that was and that information was. And I kept it private and I kept my nose down and I worked really hard. And she would say, whenever you see a position around here that you think you can do, you tell me and I'll try to help you achieve that. So I would be like,
what a wonderful
Well,
one.
How about I could be an associate producer, or I could do this, or I could be a booker, or I could be a field producer, you know? So I kind of got my bearings there.
I give you so much credit for speaking up and saying I would like to do that. That's not easy. That's an intimidating place to be, but you grew trusting of one another, I think.
And you bring up a very interesting point, which I haven't thought that much, is that I was willing to do anything. I was willing to do anything.
Yeah.
To be in show business. Because I already felt like I had failed. I felt like that I came out here, I thought I was gonna be famous. That didn't happen. And I realized it wasn't going to happen, luckily, early, that I didn't really have the desire for it. Maybe I wasn't talented enough. I probably wasn't talented enough. Maybe I wasn't good looking enough. I wasn't connected enough. I didn't know the right people. I wasn't playing the game in the right way. I realized it. The point is, I realized it. I realized the handwriting was on the wall, that wasn't going to happen for me.
It's not even that. Sometimes I think people think that they're not good enough, but really it's the casting directors have a certain role they're looking for.
Right.
You don't have green eyes,
right.
So you're not going to get that part. You don't do Taekwondo, so you're not going to get that part. And it's the people that are willing to wait and risk losing out on their 20s and their youth. And it's
right.
a huge, it's your life.
Right.
You know, and
well,
I think you knew that life was more important than waiting around.
And I'm also 6'2", and they would always say, wow, you're really tall. You're so tall. Like when I would go to auditions. And
oh,
I
really?
Thought, oh, well, I don't fit, you know, because the girls are mm-hmm. shorter or the,
right.
the
people are small out here. Yeah.
They're smaller.
Yeah.
You know, because you have to fit. You have to be the right size
mm-hmm.
to be opposite someone. And I think I was too self-aware to be an actor. I think really good actors are people who are not so self-aware.
You're extremely self-aware. The amount of times that you
mentioned.
I think you, I think that you also, a lot of people in their 20s, I'm sure you were in your 20s then.
Yeah.
You seem to have a lot of self-thought. You are always thinking about situations and kind of figuring them out in your head. Like, how come this didn't work? It seems like you didn't just take no and then walk away.
No, I didn't.
No, but maybe it's because of this or because of this.
I was self-reflective.
Okay,
I was able to look in the mirror. But I think you hit the nail on the head when you talk about a work ethic. It was really and truly about the work ethic.
Yes.
You know, I grew up in the South. My parents were, you know, they worked really hard to go from, you know, families that were definitely on the lower side of middle class to move themselves into the middle class. And they worked really, really hard, as did everyone in my family.
Right.
Everyone around me, you know, my dad's parents were farmers, and they didn't
have
a lot. Yeah, they didn't have a lot. You know, they weren't educated people, like my grandparents, and they grew tobacco, and you know, it's North Carolina. It's very rural North Carolina. So I grew up around people who worked really hard for what they had.
Right.
And I just innately understood that mm-hmm. that was part of the game. And I still do. Sometimes I leave my office at like 7:30 at night and I'm driving home with the dog in the back of the car and thinking and feeling guilty. And I'm like, what is wrong with you? It's 7:30, it's 7:45. And I'm driving home and thinking, I should have put more time in, I should have stayed longer. And that's just nuts.
Have you ever felt good enough?
So that's the bad, no.
No.
No, no. Oh my God, this is like therapy. If you really want to know the truth about me, the thing that I'm trying to work on at this stage of my life is to stop and smell the roses. Is to stop and go, hey, wow, we accomplished something together. You know, and to celebrate the things that are the failures and to celebrate the successes as well, because in the business that I'm in, most of what we do fails. It's tremendous rejection. You know, when you think about a hit show like Dance Moms, there's a lot of talent, there's a lot of luck, And there's a lot of, you know, catching lightning in a bottle to have a show like that.
And they all have to come together at the exact same
time. They all have to come together at the same time. And to think that you or one person or two people created that, it's foolish. It's absolutely foolish. And that'll lead you down a road that has a dead end. Because I recognize that, you know, Abby and the Dance Moms and the producers and myself and the network, we all played a role in it. We all realized that we had something really, really special. Mm-hmm. And we all did our part to craft it, to get it into the place that it is, you know, that became what it is that you see on television. And, you know, Abby has tremendous talent. She's a very, very talented TV performer. And that's not something that you can teach. It's not something that you can guide someone in. She just is. She's a bigger than life personality, and she doesn't edit. She says what's on her mind. She's the opposite of what I was. You know, when I was trying to be in front of the camera, I was very self-conscious and very self-aware, and I don't think she is. I think what you see is what you get, you know?
Yes. I think a lot of times people who are highly intelligent as well, and they're right. And they are business, you know, I think you were also thinking about, because you have a very strong business sense. I mean, you were trying to brand yourself, I think, when you would go into these rooms. I think you were trying to figure out your type. You were trying to figure out what the casting directors were thinking. You were trying to figure out, did I pick the right outfit today? Do I know my lines? I just think that you were so self-aware.
Right.
And you know, that works in certain settings. In producing, that's why you're where you are.
Well, and you go back to, like, when you think about great talent, and, you know, sure, I think that we have some very, very good producers who work at Collins Avenue. We're doing a new show with Abby called Abby Studio Rescue.
Yes.
And I brought you a promo.
Yes, we're going to show that.
So the amazing thing about Abby and her talent is that the show is about her going into failing dance studios. So it sort of has the same DNA that Dance Moms has, but she, you know, they're one episodes. So it's a little bit like a bar rescue kind of show.
Yes.
You've seen those Tabitha's Takeover, those kind
we
of
We love
shows.
John Taffer here at AfterBuzz.
And she's amazing at it. And
he's
she
awesome.
I called her actually on the way over here and told her how good she was, because I think it comes on July, I think
24th.
It's July 24th.
Isn't it June 20th?
I think it's July 24th.
July 24th.
I could be wrong.
Okay, I know we'll post it.
Post it up, please, because I apologize.
I have it written down, but
I should know this because
I have it written down, actually. You told
like
me
names
yesterday.
And dates. But anyway, you know, when you think of someone like her, you can.
June 24th.
June 24th. All right.
9 p.m.
The thing about Abby that's so amazing is, like, you can say to her, you know, when she's about to go through the door and meet someone for the first time, you go, look, this is the issues. This is these persons. These are the four points that we need you to hit. What's going on here?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, what is it that you want to, the parts of the story that we want you to tell in mm-hmm. order to make it make sense to the audience. You know, when you just give her like four or five, sometimes six bullet points, and she's like, okay, I got it. And then she goes into it, you know,
yeah,
she storms her way into it, and she's herself, and she talks, and she's extemporaneously telling stories, and she's like saying hello, and she remembers all those points about, and she works them in effortlessly.
See, I don't
That's
think
real
she's
talent.
It's talent.
That's
and
talent.
I think that it's not so much that she's self-aware in the sense that
she just remembers
she
it.
She oozes with confidence,
yeah.
though. She really does.
Confidence,
and she,
yeah.
she It really is confidence, because she tells herself, I've got this.
Yeah.
And she walks in like, I got this. I don't give a crap what I look like.
Right.
Whatever. My hair's going to get messy. I got this. And that's
well,
how she walks in.
That's funny. That's what she says to me when I said, she goes, I got this.
No
really?
Way.
I got this. Really? Seriously.
Hey, look
at it. Get out of my face. I got this.
Yeah, that's so funny. I just feel like that's what she would say.
No, it is. That's what she says.
Yeah.
I got this. Get out
right.
of it. Really, Jeff?
Right.
Really? Seriously?
Right. Exactly. And I think that you can almost trick yourself into
right.
being super confident. And
yeah.
There's been so many times I've done things that I'm like, I don't know what I'm going to do, but
right.
I got this. And like, you just figure it out.
Well, I'm the same way when it's me pitching, you know, because pitching
yes.
for us is like auditions.
You're kind of like a salesman in a sense.
It's completely a salesman. And there's so much rejection. You know, I have a staff of people who are in development, and their job and what they're paid for is to come up with new ideas. And we spend a lot of money developing. And, you know, in today's marketplace, you really need to go into the market with a reel. So if I was making a sales reel about this show, imagine what that would be like if
mm-hmm.
I was shooting you and shooting the studio
mm-hmm.
and saying this is what the show is and this
yep.
is what the TV, you know, imagine how much money that costs to do that. And you have to edit it and you
yes.
have to make it slick. And, you know, so you go into these pitch meetings and you put it in and you play it for them. And then you come out and you're, you know, you're really enthusiastic and you're trying to explain to them why this is going to work and why this is a great idea. And just to be shot down like over and over and over and over again, like, you know, cable network after cable network after cable network. And then you have to understand, that is the nature of what we do. Right. Most of what we do, 99% of what we do, doesn't work. It doesn't. So when you think of production companies that are really successful and they have three or four or five shows, imagine the volume of material that they have to put out in today's marketplace
to
in
get
order
three
to
or
get
four.
To get three or four.
You have no idea. You never think about it.
Oh, it's overwhelming. Yeah.
And it's interesting that you've gone, everything you've ever aspired to do, everything you've actually done has been something very difficult, almost unattainable in a sense. You've gone for acting. You've gone for singing on stage. You've gone, you know, TV hosting, working for Lisa Gibbs. It's like you do know yourself. You do know what you're worth and you do know what you can do. And I love that because you I don't think you even know that. Because if you didn't think anything of yourself, you would be working, I mean, not to knock any job, but you wouldn't be doing what you're doing.
No, that's true. I mean, I certainly don't have the pedigree. I don't have the education. I don't have the background that a lot of people who have achieved what I've achieved have. But I have the work ethic. Mm-hmm. I have the work ethic.
That's the
and
only
I'm
thing
the
that
guy,
matters.
Well, and you know, I'm
it
the
really
guy
is.
Who's willing to. And sometimes it's interesting in life when you see people in a certain scenario, like let's call them your peers. Mm-hmm. Let's take you for example. I'll use you as an example.
All right.
Let's say that you see people in your peer group who are, you know, they're on TV like you are. They're hosting a show. You have a career. You have a vision of where you want that career to be. And you know, maybe they're throwing shade at you, you know, because they think they're better than you, or they think they have more talent than you, or they're better looking than you, or they're going to be more successful than you. Okay, I'm the guy that's had that happen to me my whole life, and I just kind of find it amusing when people underestimate me like that, because the thing that I look at them and I think subconsciously in my head is I think, okay, you may be all of those things. You may be better looking than me. You may be more talented than I am. You're probably more educated than I am, but you're not willing to work as hard as I am, and I will beat you at it eventually. It may take me a long time, but I will beat you at it eventually. And in many, many situations, I do. I always have.
All you have out here is your reputation. It's all you
well,
have.
Yeah,
and you've created one that when people hear Jeff Collins, oh, that guy, yeah, that guy works really hard.
Well,
that
thank
guy,
you.
And that's what you've created. You've literally had a blank slate, and that's what you did on it. You created something. You created an identity that people hear your name, and that's the first thing that comes to mind.
You know, I started a production company.
And I'm not saying stupid people that like write online.
I
I'm saying people that are
well,
actually
that.
Care and actually know what's going
yeah,
on.
Yeah, I mean, look, we've created a brand, and we're very well respected in the reality community, and now we're venturing into scripted, and we're doing digital, and we're signing people like Viners and people who are stars on YouTube, and we're doing a lot of work. You know, we have a lot of really big clients. I think the thing that's really, that I get a lot of gratification out of is, look, I started my business with someone else's money when the economy was literally crashing into the rocks, like in 2008. I mean, the whole world seemed like it was coming apart. And I had this business deal with a company from, you know, some investors from the UK. And in the deal, they were about to pull out of the deal because, you know, the board of directors was saying, why are you throwing money, risking at this guy? You know, I'd run a production company for 2 or 3 years, but I'd never owned one. I'd never run my own company. Okay. I'd sort of been the creative head of one.
Now, that was September Films?
September Films, yeah.
And now you're talking about content media in regards
exactly.
to Collins Ave. Okay.
So because of the success of September Films and a show called Bridezillas that I was very, very involved with. I didn't create it, but I was very, very involved with producing it for many, many years.
That's
and kind of felt like I was
show.
The one that got it on the right track and it went on for 8 or 9 seasons and is seen in 150 countries all around the world. Because of the success of that one show, okay, there were people who were willing to come to me and give me money to start my own company. And I was like, well, are you kidding me? And if I fail, I don't have to pay it back? No, it's a wash. It's investor money. So we were in the midst of making this deal and the economy was literally unraveling. So, you know, they came back to me and they said, well, you know, the board of directors and they're worried. And I said, I got on the phone with the CFO, CEO one night, just the two of us. I said, no lawyers, no agents. And I said to him, I said, look, how about this? Let's redo the deal. If I'm not a success in 24 months, and meaning by a success that I have a series sold and on the air, and by a series, I mean 8 episodes. If I can't prove to you that I can do that in 24 months, you can pull the plug.
You love
now,
a challenge.
Now, 24 months is not a lot of time.
No, it's not. You love a challenge, huh?
Not a lot of time. Look, you know what? I didn't have a choice. I didn't have a choice. Mm-hmm. I opened my company and it was a one little office, 1,000 square feet, with myself and an assistant and a development executive who was new at being a development executive. The three of us.
No freaking way.
I did not have a choice. It was, and I remember I would drive home every day and I would go, "This is sink or swim, sink or swim. You're gonna swim or you're gonna go into the water and drown, because where else are you gonna get a job?" Because understand, I had pulled away from being a showrunner years before that. So I had not been in the field and I was not really competitive in that marketplace, like being a legit, executive producer. So, when I was older than a lot of producers, I mean, a lot of executive producers are in their 20s and in their early 30s, and I was older than that. And so I knew that I was aging myself out of that game, because it's not unlike acting. There are different stages of your producing career where when you start to get 40, you're up against people who are in their 25 and 26. Well, why are they going to hire? Because the job is so challenging and you're traveling and you're, it's not that you're too old to do it, but a lot of times you just don't want to do it because it's like, how much longer do I want to be on the road?
Right.
I got dogs and a house and like
dogs are like babies.
Somebody who wants me at home. You know what I mean?
Right.
It's like you figure like, in your own life, when you start to build a life, you don't want to do that anymore.
No, absolutely.
So you start
not.
Turning those jobs down, and so I knew that when I opened Collins Avenue, that those opportunities, that life, all those things that I did before, I knew that was gone. I knew that I couldn't go back there because it had been too long, and it was literally, I remember telling myself, sink or swim.
And this was 5 years ago.
Motherfuckers. Yeah, it was literally sink or swim. Like your ass is gonna drown, and I just thought to myself, and
you are a risk taker.
I thought, there's no one standing on the bank with a raft. I don't see a person. Like, this is, you better fuck pull this out. You better make this happen.
Unbelievable, and you did,
and I did, and I'm at
you
a place.
Did.
I set those goals for myself. Now I feel like I'm. I look at where I want to be. I look at where I want the company to be, where I'm sitting here today. And so when you asked me before, like, what my issues are, how we were talking about, my thing is, I don't know when to stop and smell the roses. That's the thing that I'm trying to learn at this stage in life, is to stop and go, wow, that was a great accomplishment. Or, at least take the people around me in my circle and go, hey guys, we did 100 episodes of Dance Moms. That's a really big deal. It's being seen in all around the world. It's the number one show in Australia. It's the number one show in England. Our version of it.
Do you think you're afraid that if you do stop and smell the roses, you may become lazy, or you may step back 5 steps in your life? Or
maybe, because I think that when I accomplish something, what other people think is an accomplishment, I always look at it like, okay, great, we did that. Now what's next?
Right.
I'm always looking at what's next. And I don't think that's a good thing.
Now, you started at the bottom.
Right.
And I think that's really where you got a lot of your strength and a lot of your, how you encouraged yourself to continue. But when you're already at a level where you're successful, now you're looking to find, like, what's going to motivate me now? I don't need the money. I don't need the fame. So what is it? So I think that you're just looking to find whatever that is that's going to keep you driving. But really what it is you just are somebody who's goal oriented. And you are just somebody who's driven. So it doesn't really matter if you have $1 million or $1 billion or $1,000.
It doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. You're just a driven person. Right. And so that will always be there, regardless if you sit back and smell the roses for 10 minutes, or if you go to Bermuda and relax, or if you're working till 10 o'clock at night.
Well, and I think the thing that I really enjoy the most is work. I enjoy work. And I was trying to make a decision about a business decision recently, and it was Lisa. I was on the phone. I was texting her. We were talking because we're still very close. And I was telling her, it's a really big decision. I'm not really sure what I'm going to do. And I remember she wrote me back and she said, do you still feel competitive? Are you hungry? Do you want it? Like, do you want to work? And I was thinking, yes, you're right. And I knew what decision I should make, because it was, do I still feel competitive? Do I still feel hungry? I think that was the thing she said. Do you still feel hungry? And I thought, oh my gosh, you're so right. Yeah, I do. I feel all those things. Okay, so now I know what decision to make.
Yeah, yeah. It's never about, okay, I'm comfortable in my finance. I'm secure financially.
I'm never comfortable. Never comfortable.
And that's why you'll always be successful, because you're never comfortable. Uh-uh. The people who are comfortable sit on the couch.
I don't know how. I don't know how to do that. I wish someone would teach me that.
I'll teach you.
I don't know how to sit down and watch a movie at home. I have to literally go to a movie theater in order to be able to do that. Because if you put me in front of the television at home, you know, when you put on a movie or you go to Netflix or you pop in a DVD, I'm going to start in within minutes. I'm going to
be guy that lights up the phone at the movie theater.
Or I'm like, oh my gosh, did I pick up the dog poop? Let's go outside. I got to pick up dog poop. You know what I mean? Or did someone water the plants in the pot on the back steps?
Oh my God, you're so like ADD. Like, it's so funny. You're like, wait, what's this? You're always thinking about something. It's hilarious.
Does the laundry need doing? Like, what's going on? Like, I cannot sit still. I don't know how.
I've always been
that guy.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's annoying.
I relate. I'm exactly
it's
the same.
It's totally annoying for other people, too.
No, it is very annoying for other people. It's very hard to find a companion that actually understands. You have to find someone who's very patient.
Yeah.
Friend-wise, whatever it is, like that person needs to be very patient and understand where you're coming from. Otherwise, it's not easy because you're all over the place.
The thing that I think is different about me, I've realized that's different about me at this stage of my career and of my life, is that for the very first time, I do cherish my alone time.
Good.
I need it. Okay. I need to be alone.
Yes.
I need to be alone 3 or 4 nights a week because there's a lot of catching up that I need to do because mm-hmm. I watch, The Office has my TiVo. You know, you can go to TiVo and go online and so when new shows come out, they'll IM or, you know, email one of my assistants I'll come home and there'll be shows on my DirecTV guide. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, okay, that's my homework. So a lot of those are things that I don't want to watch with someone else because I want to, you know, they may not be someone else's cup of tea.
Right.
And it's homework. So it's a lot of homework. Right. And I have 3 dogs. And so I'm the kind of person that's driven to want to go home after this because I'm already thinking about, you know, I'm going to go home tonight and Willis needs a bath. So that's my evening. See how glamorous my life is? I'm going home tonight and Willis is going to get a bath. Willis is my 10-month-old Wheaton Terrier. And so I looked at him this morning when I left. And I actually went home at lunch because my office is really close by. And I looked at him and I was like, oh my God, you're filthy. Like,
you don't understand how much I love dogs.
You've been outside and you're going to get a bath as soon as I get home tonight. So,
that's how glamorous my life is. What kind of dogs do you have?
I have 2 Wheaton Terriers.
Oh my gosh.
And a Lakeland Terrier.
Oh my gosh.
I have a Wheaton Terrier who's going to be 13 next month. I have a Wheaton Terrier, Willis, who comes to the office a lot, who's 10 months old. And I have a Lakeland Terrier, Zoe, who's 7, 8.
I love the names.
Yeah.
I love the names.
Buster,
really cool.
Zoe, and Willis.
I love the names. Yeah,
they're
awesome.
Yeah, they're cool dogs.
Do they go? So,
but it's a lot of work. Three dogs is a lot.
It is. I don't even know how. 3 dogs. My mom has 2 dogs at home, and she literally sleeps downstairs on the couch so that the dogs are comfortable.
It's a lot.
It's all about It's all about them because they're like your babies.
They, you have to look. I'm very organized. I'm a very organized person. So they have their area at the house. They have a doggy door that can go in and out. I have an assistant who helps me, with them a little bit, who will come in the morning and feed them and take them for a walk because I go to the gym really early. And who helps me with things like shopping and making sure the food's there. And two of them are on medication. That's like what happens when you get dogs that really. One has one kind of medication that you have to get from this vet, and the other has a different kind of medication that you have to. Okay, I don't have time to do that.
I know.
It's thank God I have a little bit of help to do that.
Yes.
And just to keep the dogs like organized and make sure they're fed and make sure they have their areas
clean. They're
loved
too. They need to be checked on. You know.
And they get a walk and they're happy and that kind of stuff makes me happy because I think that like draws me out of my crap. You know.
You're totally right. That's exactly what it is.
Because I don't have kids. You know. I'm worried about them. I'm focused on like what do they need? Oh, they're out of hooves. Like we need some hooves to chew on. Like. Willis needs some new toys. He's bored with his toys. Like, I focus on stuff like that. Like
Willis. Like, oh my God. Willis. I love the name.
I know. He's cool.
Willis.
He's cool.
I love it. I think that you are somebody that, you know, at the end of the day, you look for things to like you said, like to kind of to escape to, just in your mind. Like, the dogs give you 10 minutes mm-hmm. to just think about other things in life other than work. And it's like freedom in a sense. It's freeing for you.
Yeah, it is.
It's like taking a bath, but I don't think you can take a bath. I'm sure you'll just be
I'm
not a bath. I hate
baths.
I'm
not a bath person.
I can't.
No, I have like 4 bathrooms in my house, and only one of them has a bathtub.
I tried yoga. That
got
was
rid of
the.
They're all showers. Like, yeah.
When you work out, do you work out like treadmill and stuff like fast?
You know what? I do a really. I do the treadmill. I need to do it more. I do the treadmill 2 times a week. Okay. I try to do 2 times a week, but I do a really interesting workout that's part Pilates and part lifting weight.
Oh, nice.
Because I injured myself a few years ago because I used to lift really heavy weight and I was a lot bigger. But I injured my back. I have like a little tiny bone spur that pokes me in the back. And so I went to this doctor and he said, well, I could cut you open, but it's not that bad. Or I could stick a big needle in you and make it numb, but you don't really need that. He goes, what I'd recommend is some Pilates. And I'm like, I'll take number three.
Yeah,
so
right.
I went for the first time, I went to do Pilates, and I didn't know anything about Pilates, but I did it because the doc said, you know, it'll help you stand up straight because mm-hmm. you're over a computer, you're mm-hmm. like hunched over all day. So in this workout that I do with my friend who's a trainer, it's a lot of, you know, posture training and standing up straight and core work. And then we throw the weights in, you know, like to keep
strengthening.
Yeah, to keep the strength
in your back. Yeah.
You know, try to keep my shoulders.
It elongates your
exactly.
muscles.
Exactly. And I can tell.
Makes you taller, not that you need that.
It's amazing. It's amazing. It reminds me a lot of like going to dance class.
Yes.
What that felt like to go to dance class. Because you're really, you're pulling yourself up and you're making yourself stand up straight. You know.
Feels so good.
Because when I started doing it, I felt like I had really bad posture. And I have a tendency to not stand up straight anyway.
Me too.
You know, because I'm tall and I'm always like hunched over a computer. But it really does remind you. I highly recommend it.
Yeah.
Even if you can't afford to do Pilates, like just go take a Pilates class where there's 4 or 5 people in it.
Yes.
You'll figure it out.
Yes.
It's not that hard.
Totally. Yeah. Totally.
It's a great workout.
Speaking of dance.
Yes.
So Dance Moms, when did that come about? You obviously, as a producer, you don't, to give an understanding to the people who are listening and watching, how did you figure out what Dance Moms was? Like, did you hear from, did someone pitch it to
you? Well, there
are
many different stories about how Dance Moms came about.
Let's set the record straight.
So, well, I mean, this is my story. This is my reality. There are other people that have a different reality, some of whom you've had on this show. But from the executive producer who owns the company's reality, there's a casting director, Brian Stenson, who was a casting director. He's an executive producer now, but he was a casting director, and he is my best friend for many, many, many years, has been a great friend of mine. And he was leaving a job. And so I said to him, hey, come and work at my company. It's new. Help me out. You know, while you're looking for a job, here's some money I can pay you. So we started talking about, you know, different worlds. And I said to him, if you can find a show for me, you know, we'll cut you in and we'll make it work. So we talked about all these different worlds of what made sense. And I had gone to Lifetime because an executive there named Gina McCarthy and I had done Bridezilla's together.
I was just going to say, was it Bridezilla's?
Back at Women's Entertainment. And then there's another executive there, Rob Sharano, and Rob and I had done Billy the Exterminator together at A&E. So Rob and Gina were together as a team, and Lifetime was going through this huge rebrand, and they didn't have any programming. And so Gina said to me, come to New York, I want to sit down with you. And so I sat down with her and she goes, look, you know how to make this really, she called it buzzy stuff, you know, which is loud and a lot of controversy. I need you to bring me something loud and buzzy in that sort of like the way Bridezilla's was, but not really Bridezilla's, you know, because we've already done that show together. And I thought, well, what can I do? So I was thinking about the mother-daughter relationship and how that relationship is so unique.
Yes.
And I thought, a woman's network, mother, let's explore the mother. So I started talking to Brian about how do we explore the mother-daughter relationship? And we were thinking like, well, look, there's only, you know, what do mothers and daughters do together? And dance kept coming up. And I thought, man, there's something there. And so he'd already been thinking about that. He already had a show in his mind about Dance Moms. And so he'd already been working on that. And he just said, hold on a second, you know, I may have something. So he'd already been working on casting.
And
so there was a good friend of his, John Carella, who happened to be Abby Lee Miller's, you know, very, very dear friend, who had been talking to Brian, and they'd been consulting because Brian did Showbiz Moms and Dads years ago on Bravo. So he understood that space very well. He understood the Showbiz Moms and Dads space. So he and John Carella had been talking about dance studios, and so the idea, when you think about like how it all comes together, like I wanted to explore the mother-daughter space. Those two guys were already searching and looking in the dance world, and that happened to be mother-daughter. And then John Carella kept saying to Brian, unbeknownst to me, there's this woman, Abby Lee Miller, she's my friend. You gotta go. So they started with the process.
Unbelievable. Going back to the moment where you said everything has to come into play, like you send out so many things. This is literally the talent, and then the people, and then the casting. It's like it all just fit into a puzzle.
But you know what it is? It's a lot. It's teamwork. Gina and Rob said to me, we need something that's loud and buzzy for this network. I went to my friend Brian and said, I need something to take to them that's in this space. I didn't know exactly what it was. I didn't have the idea. And so those guys had already been talking about it. So it's a matter of like back to asking, mm-hmm. what did I do? What did they do? They asked me mm-hmm. for what they needed. What did I do? I went to the people I knew and I asked for what I needed.
Yes.
And so all those pieces of the puzzle came together. And the very first piece of footage I saw, I think they sent a flip cam to, it was either Christy or Kelly, and I have it somewhere.
No way.
And they were up
God.
In the, they were literally up in the parent area, and they were sort of taping themselves, unbeknownst to Abby. I don't think she even knew that they were taping it. And they were taping her with a flip cam while she was teaching. And I don't even think she knew that they were taping them. And that was the very first piece of footage I saw.
And you just were
won. Christy and Kelly.
You were bought. You were won over.
I was
right?
Like, oh my gosh, it's so compelling. Like it, because of the way it was laid out and the way Abby had the parent booth, you know, up above the bird's nest where they were like looking down and dancing.
That's very rare. That dancing,
I've never seen it before.
I grew up dancing my whole life. Yeah. You couldn't even, there was not even like a little, there was like a little peephole or something where the moms could peek sometimes, but they didn't want, most teachers don't want parents watching
because
right. they get involved and they get catty and they're like, why isn't my daughter in the front? And that's, but there you, it's like the perfect starting ground for a show like this.
Well, and Abby's dad built that studio for her. So I think maybe that was part of her original idea, was that she didn't want the parents in her face. Like, put them up there so that there's a place for them to be so that they can actually watch, but they can't bother me.
But you can still hear, she could still hear them when they're talking very
she
loudly.
She can. And you know what the interesting thing about that is? The way it's built, you, if you were to go to the other side of it, there's a dance studio on the other side as well. So yeah, she can hear them. She can hear them if they get loud enough up there.
So from there, you have this flip, this video.
Yeah, we started putting this stuff together, you know, and we, so from the very beginning of like the little tiny bit of flip cam video that we had, I don't completely remember how it transpired from there. I just remember that I was hooked. And I don't remember if Brian and John went to shoot something or I don't remember how it transpired, but we eventually ended up with a reel, you know, that really explained what the show was, and we took it to Lifetime and they were willing to put it on the air. You know?
Amazing.
They went literally straight to series from a presentation reel. Six episodes.
Did you ever think for one moment that it would be what it is today?
No, I didn't. You never know. Yeah. You never know. I mean, and there were many times when I thought, you know, it might go away because I thought, oh, the moms are tired of doing this or Abby's tired of doing it. Or, you know, sometimes the battles get pretty heated and things get, you know, out of control. And and you think, a lot of times I've thought, is this the end of it? Is this the end? I mean, I've wondered that, you know, last season. Is this the end? Is it over? And then for whatever reason, you know, because of the way that the show is laid out, it really is so real. Because think about it.
Tears, I mean, that's enough.
Well, and for people to think that, you know, we producers are behind that or we're the ones who are guiding that, that's so ludicrous. Because, I mean, God, if it could be scripted, it would be so much easier to make if we could write the script. But the truth of the matter is they show up, you know, they rehearse. There's a pyramid where Abby sort of sets the stakes at the top of the show by deciding, you know, who she feels is in favor that week. So imagine that sets the stakes right at the top of the show. And then people are assigned solos and duets, all right? So that creates a storyline right there because of what's going on. And then they start down the path of learning numbers and rehearsing. And then they go to a competition. Somebody wins, somebody loses, somebody cries, they go home, and they come back the next week, and the next week's story is all driven by what it was that happened the previous week.
It's amazing.
So as long as they continue to compete and continue to go to those dance competitions, you know, the story continues to just generate itself.
Yep.
So when you think about reality shows or shows that don't work because the characters, or they wear out quickly, it's because the producers, you know, have to start coming up with things for them to do.
And you can feel the force. You can feel it's not authentic. It's not being true to who they are.
No.
I don't think for one second any of those women or Abby or even the children think about the cameras. I really don't sense that. I don't. Are you guys very far away from them when you tape?
You know, no. I mean, sometimes we are very close to them and sometimes we're not. But I think they're so used to the cameras, it doesn't come into play with them anymore. I mean, and look, all the moms are very individual. They have very distinct personalities. They have very distinct points of view. Mm-hmm. And even as close as they are, they don't allow each other to change their POV. That's what I love about them.
Yes.
Is they all have very, very...
It's the best thing you could
ever
ask for.
They have very distinct personalities.
They really
do. And the more the show goes on, the more they are entrenched in their point of view, I should say.
Yes. And they don't... what made you decide to get involved physically and actually become the host for the reunions? Like, because you could have very easily said, I want this person.
Oh my God, it was by default. It was literally by default. Yeah. So the first reunion show we did, we were looking around at a host and we thought, well, who can we throw into this situation? Like, it's not exactly...
They have to know about dance a little bit.
Well,
they have to
watch
the show.
It's not exactly a group that's not intimidating. I mean, to sit next to them on the couch when they're... you know, in the midst of a heated argument, it's not exactly like you could take someone and just sort of throw them into that mix. And so we kept looking around at, like, and this, I mean, we, the network and myself, we were looking around at, you know, different host talent. And we thought, well, should it be someone funny? And should it be someone unknown? And, you know, and when you do the very first one, you don't have a lot of money to pay because the network doesn't know if these things will rate. They don't know if anybody's going to watch or care other than just the fans of the show. And so I remember them saying to me, well, we've seen you do interviews before. Why don't you do it? You'll
this
be fine.
Amazing. Oh, my God.
And I'm
God.
Like, really, guys? Like, that? I'm your choice? Like, out of default? Well, we can't get anyone else to do it. And they go, well, you just do it. You'll be fine. And I thought, oh my God. Well, that's a ringing endorsement. And so I said to them, I said, all right, look, I'll do it. But if I suck at it, if I'm terrible at it, will you promise me that you'll tell me? And you'll replace me because I don't want to be, you know, don't feel as though this is a favor to me because I don't really want to be on TV. I don't care.
Right.
I'm just doing this to facilitate the job. So luckily my producing team said, okay, look, you're just here to be the traffic cop. Don't make this about you. Keep it about them and just keep the story
Lisa
moving.
Lisa taught you that, correct? Didn't she
teach
you that?
She absolutely did teach me that. And because, you know, I watched people, you know, there was a time when we did talk shows the way we do reality shows now, where there were a lot of talk shows. Mm-hmm. And I think that because I had taught so many people how to do that job, how to be a talk show host, I just sort of innately understood mm-hmm. not to get in the way. I kind of innately understood, like, how to read the prompter and the fact that you're also thinking about, you know, you got questions in your lap and how do I keep talking to you and keep you engaged and not look down at the questions and, you know, like all those things to try to make it as smooth as you can so that, you know, and make it about the other person so that I'm not really talking about myself that much. So I did it and the network was like, yeah, you were fine.
Isn't it amazing the moment you don't want to be on TV anymore is when you get your 5 minutes? I mean, really, not the 5 minutes. It's like a half an hour, hour, whatever.
But
it is
my 2 minutes of fame.
It has grown. You've grown, you know, into now an on-camera personality.
Well, and we do.
Not even wanting to do that.
It's astonishing.
The moment
you think about,
don't want it.
When you roll the clock back and you think about what I would have given anything to have that opportunity when I first got to Hollywood, and now the fact that I'm doing it and I don't care about it.
That's
and
why
I really
you're so
don't,
good at it.
And I don't care if it goes away. It doesn't matter if it goes away. It's just, you know, it's not my job. My job is to be a producer and a production company owner. But I do like it. I'm happy to do it. I tell you what I'm happy is I like to go, you know, get the nice suits.
Oh, you do have some.
Yeah, I get to wear
slick suits. I like those. I like that. And I also like that you don't really have to watch the episode. Like, if you miss the episode and you just catch Dance Moms Reunion, you know exactly what happened. You paint a picture in people's heads of beginning to end. You storytell. You recap it. We need you here recapping with us.
Well, I'm always thinking when the moms are sitting there and Abby's sitting there, I'm always thinking about, I wonder if the person watching this really understands the story.
Totally, totally. Because you really are invested in
that. Okay, wait a minute. Let's go back and explain to everybody what mm-hmm. happened. You
know? Right.
So that's the greatest compliment that you could have given me is that understand.
Well, I was just being honest.
Well, thank you.
Really, because you do tell a story. You recap the whole thing and you don't let them get out of control because you allow them to do it a little bit, but you reel them back in. You say, listen, we're talking about this story right now. Let's not move to Z. We're at B. You know,
thank God we have the time and the space to edit that because if you only knew what happened, way it unfolded live and they all get going and it's just trying to reel them back in.
Oh my God, I can't even imagine. Because, I would love to be a fly in the wall one of those reunions.
You bring up issues that are sensitive. You rehash old wounds. And all of a sudden, the argument becomes very real again. Or the controversy becomes very real again. And then everybody wants to be heard.
Right.
And sometimes people want to be heard again. And sometimes people want to be heard again and again. And it's like, okay, we get it. We get it. Let's move on.
I love it. And now we have, I know we don't have a lot of time, but quickly I want to say we have Abby's Studio Rescue.
Yes.
And we're going to play that in just a second. But we also have Raising Asia.
Now that I don't know about.
Okay, because it was on Google.
When?
It was on Google. I Googled it the other day.
Oh.
It said on LinkedIn. Someone's LinkedIn has it.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that it had been announced. Oh.
Well, I don't know if it was announced, but it was on LinkedIn.
Yeah, so. I don't know about that one.
Okay,
yeah.
Well, there. But the Studio Rescue.
Yeah.
And that one is basically, like you said, she's like a bar rescue, kitchen nightmares type of thing. So there are rumors that, you know, there are all these other shows. Nothing's been released yet. But do you think in the future there'll be other shows?
You know what I do? I think that as long as there are moms and daughters who go to dance class, I think that this area will always be interesting to watch. Yes. And I think every year there's a new mom and a new daughter that go to dance class. And I think as long as that continues to happen, which I don't see that drying up anytime soon, I think that we will, this area will always be ripe for discussion.
Yes.
I really do.
I do too.
And you know, the thing about what's really interesting about the world of dance is that even in the last 10 years, the competition world has really heated up. And so now when kids go to dance class, they go to dance class because they want to be at a studio that's going to go to competitions and compete. So that's a whole other element that really wasn't present before.
Right.
You know,
totally.
You throw competition. Look, you put any parent and a child in a situation where they're competing against other children, that's ripe for drama.
Like the pageants and all that. Yeah. It's just
any of that stuff is really amazing.
I think a lot of times it's because they do, in a sense, live their dreams through their kids. Not to say dance moms like that, but at least with the pageants, It seems a lot of times they're like, the kids don't really want to do it, but they, you know, and they play a little bit more on, it's a little more disturbing when you watch like the pageant shows, truthfully, in my opinion. But this actually, I don't know what it is. I don't know if it's because the kids actually really get along and they're all very goal oriented. These kids want this. And that's the difference. The pageant kids don't usually want it.
Well, the dance kids have a work ethic.
They
have a tremendous work ethic.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
And they want it.
And I always say to the moms and I say to anybody, you know, look, whatever happens when the show is over and the girls who are on the show, if they continue on to want to be performers, I'm sure they'll be very successful. But if they don't, I know that they will be successful at whatever it is they choose to do. I don't have for a second ever in the back of my mind think that one of those kids is going to go down the wrong road. I don't.
Oh, I don't either.
I don't.
And I've seen that growing up in the dance world. A lot of people, a lot of kids have, you're like, that's her now? It's crazy.
Yeah.
But it was different though. I've never seen a work ethic, like you say, in children this young. They look like adult dancers on Broadway. It's amazing.
Yeah. None of those kids will go down the bad. None of those kids will take a bad path. I don't think that any of them will ever get into trouble.
No.
I just always think they're going to be very, very goal oriented. I think they're always going to see what hard work can do and how you can achieve from hard work. I think they're always going to have a little bit of the fame bug. I think they understand television. I think they're savvy to like, you know, Facebook and Twitter. I mean, the girls have something like 10 million.
It's insane.
And have you seen Maddie's video, the Sia video?
No.
It's crazy.
Oh, the music video.
Yeah, the music
video. Yes, yes. Unbelievable.
I mean, that's insane.
They're just obsessed. At this point, kids are just, and I think that's where also it comes with a lot of, going back, like a lot of rumors. I feel like a lot of times a show like this with so much success, there's all these crazy rumors, there's all these crazy things that people say about how they really are, this and that. But, you know, at the end of the day, as long as you love your job, you love what you do, you have a heart, you have a soul. Like, you're not gonna, you know, you actually believe in these kids, you actually believe in this show.
Right.
And I think that's why it's so successful, because you didn't just say, hey, it's making me money, like, let's, whatever, I sold the show, bye.
No, no, no,
you're,
no.
Like, invested in, you're there, you're what, obviously you watch every episode,
well,
you're
I think
really
if you
into
ha-
it.
Look, if I think you have that attitude about making television that it's just about money, I don't think that you'll have a show that lives beyond, we call it one and done in my business, which is really the worst kind of series to have, is one that only lasts for one season, you know?
Yep.
You don't want that.
Right.
You want shows that come back. And it's really hard, you know, having shows that return season after season after season, that's really an anomaly. It's difficult to do.
Yes.
It's difficult to do. So I'm thankful to the moms and Abby and the team and everybody that's involved in it.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's play the little clip that you were so gracious to bring us.
I'm taking over the studio. You have to put on a showcase for the entire
Abby has a new show.
The place is a dump.
You're driving me crazy!
Thanks, what?
When dance studios fall apart,
awesome. I'm laying down the law.
Abby is here to save the day.
You want
to
walk away? I want to turn this place away. Let's get down to business.
Come on in, our studio!
Abby's Studio Rescue, Tuesday, June 24th at 9.
Abby to the rescue.
Awesome.
On Lifetime.
We were right, June.
Isn't that awesome? Okay, great.
I am so excited for this.
Yeah, it's great. It's a really great show. It's a great show.
Are you going to keep doing reunions for other parts of like this show, obviously? Are you going to do a reunion for this?
I don't know. I haven't. I suppose if it does well and they want one.
I think you should do more.
It could be cool.
Do more. We need more cool. Jeff Collins
well,
on Lifetime.
I don't know if you need more of me. You just need more dance moms, because that's what everyone loves to watch. But I'm happy to help out in any way I can.
I love it.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank you so much for coming here today. You're so cool. You really are awesome.
Well, thanks.
Thank you so much for watching, and we will upload this to iTunes and YouTube, and have a great day. Bye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.
Thank you for watching AfterBuzz TV on YouTube. For more of your favorite after shows and interviews, subscribe to our channel here, and be sure to share your opinion on the episode in the comment section below here. We'd love to see what you guys are buzzing about. Thanks again. Buzz you later.